Good morning and welcome to Christ Episcopal Church. We welcome those of you who are joining us in person, as well as those of you who are joining us online. Please take a few moments and greet the people sitting around you, get to know one another. If you're joining us online, please use the chat feature in Zoom or message one another on Facebook and greet one another. We're very glad that God brought you to be with us today. If you're visiting for the first time, restrooms are located in the narthex, which is out the sanctuary and to your left. We invite you now to center your hearts and minds on worship as our service begins with the prayer.
Thank you. Good morning, all.
Good morning.
Dear friends in Christ, we are gathered today to celebrate the Lord's Day, and from a time to be united in prayer and praise with each other. I should take this up. With each other and those who have gone before us. Sunday has been called the Lord's Day because it was on this day that Jesus conquered sin and death and rose to life. As we gather in person and online, let us be united in spirit of Christ and the church around the world and celebrate our redemption in Christ's suffering, death, and resurrection. Light and peace in Jesus, our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witness unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria, and unto the utmost power of the earth. O God, we give thanks to the gifts of our light shining in the first day of creation, guiding us through the wilderness, leading us to the land of promise.
You sent Jesus, light of the world, to be our tree of truth and life. Help us follow him each day and rest in him each night until at last we come to live with you in endless light. Through Jesus Christ our Lord and with the Holy Spirit, we give you honor and glory now and always. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbors. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins through the Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us in all goodness and the power of the Holy Spirit. Keep us in eternal life. Amen. Amen. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open and all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify you in your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, the foundation of wisdom, you know our necessities before we ask and our ignorances in asking. Have compassion on our weakness and mercifully give us those things which for our unworthiness we dare not, and for our blindlessness we ask not, or we cannot ask. Through the worthiness of your Son Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our first reading comes to us from 2 Samuel. When the king is settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all of his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See, now I'm living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought the people of Israel from Egypt to this day. But I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel whom I commanded to shepherd my people, Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus said the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be prince over my people Israel. And I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make you a great name, like the great name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel and will plant them, so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more, as formerly, from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel, and I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares that to you that the Lord will make you a house. When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come forth from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today is Psalm 89, and we'll read it responsively, breaking at the asterisk. I have found David in my servant.
With my holy oil have I anointed him.
My hand will hold him fast.
And my arm will make him strong.
No enemy shall deceive him.
Nor any.
I will crush his foes before him.
And strike down those who hate him.
My faithfulness and love shall be with him.
And he shall be victorious through my name.
I shall make his dominion extend.
From the great sea to the river.
He will say to me, "You are my father."
My God and the rock of my salvation.
I will make him my firstborn.
And higher.
I will keep my love for him forever.
And my covenant will stand firm for him.
I will establish his line forever.
And his throne as the gates of heaven.
If his children forsake my law,
and do not walk according to my judgments,
if they break my statutes,
and do not keep my commandments,
I will punish their transgressions with a rod. But I will not take my love from him.
Nor let my faithfulness prove false.
I will not break my covenant.
Nor change what has gone out of my lips.
Once for all, I have sworn by my holiness.
I will not lie to David.
His line shall endure forever.
And his throne as the sun before me.
It shall stand fast forevermore like the moon.
Be quiet.
Our epistle today comes from second letter to the Ephesians. Remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth called the uncircumcision by those who are called the circumcision, a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. Remember that you were at the time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Jesus Christ, you once were far off, have been brought near to the blood, by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh, he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall, that is, the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with his commandments and ordinances, that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off and peace to those who were near, for through him both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also the members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus as himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you are also built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the Gospel of Mark. The apostles gathered around Jesus and told him that they had done all that they had done and taught. He said to them, "Come away to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest a while." For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And then they went away in the boat to a deserted place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them and hurried there on foot from all the towns and arrived ahead of them. As he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. When they had crossed over, they came to the land of Gennesaret and moored the boat. When they got out of the boat, people at once recognized him and rushed about the whole region and began to bring the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, Into the villages or cities or farms, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and begged him that they might touch even the fringe of his cloak, and all who touched it were healed. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Grace, peace, and mercy are yours from the triune God. Amen. Well, they say that you can pick your friends, and you can pick your nose, but you can't pick your friend's nose. Except that's not always true. You can't always pick your friends. My friend Greg is a perfect example. Greg is a loud, foul-mouthed, gay, athletic CrossFit gym rat and professional couch surfer, which makes him, maybe with just one or two exceptions, just about the exact opposite of me in every way. And the funny thing about Greg is that after posing as an Iraq war veteran and raising tons of money and public awareness for returning war veterans to receive their benefits, Greg was outed as an imposter live on cable news and charged with violating the Stolen Valor Act. And yet, after moving to Denver, Alyssa and I took a job as live-in caretakers for a Mennonite church near downtown, and part of the agreement with the church involved mowing the church lawn in the summer and shoveling snow in the winter, shoveling lots and lots of snow. An entire city block, sometimes multiple times a week. And our first winter there, one morning, after getting 2 feet of snow dumped on us suddenly and unexpectedly, out of nowhere, Greg showed up and grabbed a shovel. Greg has also worked for several pizzerias, and whenever we'd host a pizza night and invite everyone over for dinner, Greg was always there shaping the dough. I didn't choose to be friends with Greg. One day we just were. I've been in search of community long enough and worked in churches long enough to know that way too often I'm guilty of the sin of trying to decide who is worthy of my friendship. And gatekeeping is such a seductive temptation, right? Because it gives us this sense of power and autonomy, the illusion of control. I might not be able to choose what internet service provider I have, but by God, I can choose the people I want to hang out with. But God has this funny way of pushing people together who otherwise normally wouldn't be caught dead in the same room together. And I've learned that the times when I've been in a position to hand select my own community, to customize and curate my list of people I'd prefer to spend time with, I've realized that those times have often been the most stressful and short-lived periods and experiences of community. The most life-giving forms of community for me have been those experiences of people who belonged to the Isle of Misfit Toys, if you remember the old cartoon Rudolph. My fixation on pursuing the kind of community that I want has often blinded me to the blessings of the community that I actually have right in front of my own face. Perhaps more than anything else, the singular source of division in the early church involved the question of who gets the right to claim the title, the people of God. Jewish followers of Jesus saw themselves as the continuing recipients of the promises of God that were made to Abraham and Sarah, to Isaac and Rebekah, to Jacob and Rachel, to Moses and Zipporah. Gentile followers of Jesus saw themselves as a living sign that God continues to act and move in this world, completely separate from God's law and promises to Israel, sometimes going so far as to say that God had actually ended God's special relationship to Israel and was instead adopting the Gentiles as an entirely new people, no longer bound to the law or to the distinctions that separated Jews from everyone else. And in our reading from Ephesians today, to both of these two groups, both competing for ownership of the title, the people of God, Paul essentially says, you're both wrong. Because the gifts and the calling to be the beloved and chosen community of God is not a commodity that can be owned or traded like a prize at the bottom of a Happy Meal or a box of Cracker Jack. People still eat Cracker Jack, right? See, Jesus, according to Paul, was able to do what no person, no church, no liturgy or special programming was ever or will ever be able to do: to reconcile the unreconcilable, to square the circle. It is, in fact, this very Jesus, says Paul, who is the true authority over all. And to continue behaving as if we ourselves hold the keys to God's kingdom, we make idols of ourselves, worshiping our ability to decide who is and who is not worthy, as if God has not already made that decision and given us to each other as a merciful gift, as if Christ himself has not already unified us all into one temple of God's own reconciling spirit. I wish I'd have had this in mind when I met my friend Peter, who would come to our college Bible studies and take all of our snacks and then leave without staying for the study. Peter would also come into the student union where we lived and offer very loud commentary on the TV shows that we happened to be watching, and was all around the kind of person that we didn't really want to spend time with. And yet there he was, all the dang time. And it was through that experience of constantly spending time with someone we'd really rather not be around that we learned what it means to love, what it means to be part of a beloved community, what it means to find a place of belonging. Our little Isle of Misfit Toys, where all the people who didn't feel like they fit in at the other campus ministries felt like they could finally belong and be themselves, fully themselves. Or I think about me as a staunch pacifist and critic of our military-industrial complex, being befriended by my friend Emery in the Army Reserve, who, when he learned that I had never had a Bloody Mary before, made it his personal mission to introduce me to the cheapest, most delicious Bloody Mary in all of Denver. And at the heart of all this, I wonder if maybe that's why Jesus had such compassion for the crowd in our gospel reading today. Because although these people had almost nothing in common, they were like sheep in need of a shepherd. They were all in need of healing. And who among us is not in need of a shepherd and in need of healing? Who among us is not seeking for that sense of belonging? Paul says that there's actually more than just the reconciling of Jews and Gentiles. Not only has Christ become the agent of our reconciliation, but also this reconciliation that began with two irreconcilable things has only continued. That was only the beginning. Eventually, Paul says, the principalities and powers and the rulers of this world will be abolished entirely. And the entire cosmos will be drawn together into God's love. And the agent of that drawing together is none other than the power that raised Jesus of Nazareth from the grave after his crucifixion, denying and reversing the power of sin and death itself, which is still at work among us right here and right now, drawing us together to be a giant, shiny billboard of God's hope for the world. God put this power to work in Christ, Paul says, when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet and made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. At the end of the day, we discover our own belonging, our need for belonging. Not by handpicking the sorts of people that we like to hang out with, but through our encounters with people who are willing to grab a shovel and shovel snow with you, or people who will give you a ride to the airport or let you crash on their couch, or help you load up all your worldly possessions into a moving truck so you can move halfway across the country, or bring you a casserole at the death of a parent, or take you in search of the perfect Bloody Mary. And so today, my prayer is that we relinquish our need for control, and that we open ourselves to the sorts of people that God has thrown us into the lifeboat with. And may that teach us something about God's own love and mercy. Amen. Amen.
Let us affirm our faith. Do you believe in God?
We believe in God, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
We believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The prayers of the people can be found in your bulletin. Engage us, O God, in the renewal of this diocese toward your Christ-centered vision. Help us to realize that we are bound to one another in our common life and ministry. Spirit of God,
we are listening.
Empower us, O God, to energize the ministry of all the baptized, making our communities of faith healthy and holy places of your presence that reach out in compassion and hope in Christ's name. Spirit of God,
we are listening.
Unite us, O God, to be compassionate and not competitive, to be consoling and not controlling, to be faithful and not fearful as we continue to build relationships in communities centered on the vision of your reign. Spirit of God,
we are listening.
Guide us, O God, to be responsible stewards here on earth, to prophetically witness to your reign. We pray especially for members of the United Nations, for Joseph, our president, for Michael, our governor, Robert, our mayor, and other civic leaders that they may do justice and love mercy. Spirit of God,
we are listening.
Deliver us, O God, from mistrust of one another and the misuse of our gifts. Help us to see in our worshiping communities, large and small, growing and struggling your grace and promise. Spirit of God,
we are listening.
Heal us, O God, in our communities, our families, and in the hidden places of our hearts. We pray for those in this community who are ill or in any kind of need, especially Elaine Jackson, Ann Hogan, Barbara Munch, Anita Hewlett, Robert and Deanie Hadley, George and Caroline Thompson, Janet Hinson, Catherine Mitchell, Charles Roy Anderson, the emergency care providers at Southeast Hospital, and St. Nino's Episcopal Church in the country of Georgia, city of Tbilisi, providing refuge for the persecuted LGBTQ community there, and others you would name. Give us the courage and grace to be your presence among them. Spirit of God,
we are listening.
Comfort us, O God, as we remember all those saints who have gone before us in light and have finished their course of faith. Give up to the departed the comfort of your promise and presence, especially those you would name aloud and in your hearts. Spirit of God,
we are listening.
Support us, O God, as we support each other, particularly Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Dion, our bishop, Annette, our priest, and all who minister and witness in your church. Spirit of God,
we are listening.
Teach us, O God, as we journey through the Christian life to continually engage each other, young and old, in the spiritual formation, discernment, discipleship, and stewardship. Spirit of God,
we are listening.
O God, in our help in ages past, our hope for the years to come, you may have journeyed with your people, Israel, and we pray to you. Journey with us now in the time of dreaming, daring, and doing. Walk beside us on the road that is ahead. Calm our fears, awaken our hopes, and open our hearts as together we seek your guidance. Inspire us to discern your will for the Diocese of Missouri. May we put our whole trust in you as we look to Christ, the great shepherd of our souls. We together with the Holy Spirit is alive and reigns now and forever. Amen. Now, as our Savior has taught us, we now pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, ruler of the universe.
You create the fruit of the vine. In the long day when you once again refresh us with a cup of salvation in the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Glory to you forever and ever. Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, ruler of the universe.
You bring forth bread from the earth. We long for the day when we once again partake of the bread of our body, your Son, Jesus Christ. As grain scattered upon the earth is gathered into one loaf,
your Son. To you be glory and power, forever and ever. Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe.
You have blessed the earth to bring forth food to satisfy our hunger.
Let this food strengthen us in the Eucharistic fast that is before us, that following our Savior in the way of the cross, we may come to joy of his resurrection. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever. Amen.
God of all creation, we gather on this first day of the week, made holy by your resurrection of Christ, your Son. In the waters of baptism, we are buried with him so that we might also rise with him and so share his victory over sin and death.
You have transformed our lives into the living stones that form your church with Christ and the foundation of stone. Strengthen our community's bond and the community of peace, and deepen our solidarity with your church throughout the world.
Rekindle within us this Sabbath day the vision of your kingdom, so that our daily concerns and labors may find their proper perspective.
Fill our homes with the spirit of gospel, and give us grace and people with whom we live. We raise our voice in praise and thanksgiving to you, O God, that we can celebrate Christ's resurrection this day, sharing his eternal glory, where he lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
We have announcements here. It looks like they're on page 18 and 19. Is there any other announcements that are not listed here? Okay. Glory to God, whose power is working in us, can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to him for generations to generations in the church and in Jesus and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. Amen. Dear siblings in Christ, let us go forth into the world rejoicing in power of the Holy Spirit.
Thanks be to God.
Talking about the prayers and people.
Yeah.